Hello, ladies and gents, and welcome to the Repair Lair. I'm super excited to have you here today with me, because in this video mini-series, we're going to be taking a look at repairing, restoring, and modernizing this third-generation Ipod Classic. In part one of this mini-series, I will show you how you can test whether your iPod works by charging it without having the proper power cable, as well as how to swap the battery. In part two, we're going to be replacing the internal hard drive of this iPod with some solid-state flash memory. In part three, we're going to be modernizing the iPod with a modification that allows charging via regular USB cables. And in part four, we're going to be polishing the entire front faceplate to make it look brand new again. There's a lot of material that we need to cover, so let's get started. So here's the iPod I'm going to be working on. And this is the first part of the series, so as mentioned, we're going to see if we can get this old thing working again and then swap in a new battery. It's a third generation classic iPod from 2003, and it was being sold as non-working as it doesn't charge nor does it power up. After some negotiation, I got lucky to buy it from a local seller for only £10. Now this iPod is actually quite unique, because unlike others, it doesn't have any clicky buttons. All of the controls that you see here on the front, they're actually touch sensitive, which is pretty cool by 2003 standards. As expected, messing with the hold switch or touching the controls does not magically turn it on, due to the battery being empty for many, many years. Sadly, plugging in the charging cable doesn't do anything either. And I know the cable is good, as I can charge a newer iPod with it totally fine. The thing is though, these iPods were never actually capable of charging via USB cable like that, something a quick Google search easily reveals. Now if you're trying to charge one of these with a cable like that, well, there's your problem, this is not gonna work. To charge one of these bad boys as intended, you actually need a FireWire cable as well as a designated FireWire power brick. Now, I have neither of those things, and I'm not particularly keen on buying them because, as far as I'm concerned, until I test this, it's just a paperweight. But to test it, I need to somehow charge it. A quick and dirty way to test whether this old monolith still works is to pull it apart and charge the battery using a universal battery charger, like this old piece of junk I got right here. Or if you want to be more fancy, you can use a lab power supply like this one, and set it to 4 volts and use that. Now sadly, I don't have one of those at home, and stealing from work is so much more hassle than not stealing from work, so the cheap charger will have to do for now. If you have a lab power supply, you probably don't need my advice on how to use it. If you don't have either of those options available for you, well, I have a nasty hack that I'm happy to share. What you can do is take any old USB cable, chop one end off of that, and then use the power lines to substitute a universal charger. Now don't get me wrong, I don't recommend this method, because it's not safe and you really shouldn't be doing it. But then again, I would be lying if I told you I've never done it myself. To charge the battery, we need to get to the battery contacts that are inside the iPod. Getting into these iPods that have a plastic front is pretty easy. All you have to do is slide your spudger in between the plastic front piece and the metal back piece, and then release the plastic clips that are holding them together. When one side is loose, do the same on the other side, and then all of the internals should pop right out, like the contents of a flimsy burrito. Sadly, judging from the fingerprints, someone has already been inside my burrito. And hopefully they didn't mess with my jalapenos. Note that the back is connected to the rest of the assembly via this ribbon cable. Care must be taken not to rip the connector off by accident. Don't pull on the cable to disconnect it. Instead, use some tweezers to disconnect the cable by pushing the connector away from the socket, like so. The battery contacts are easy to identify. It's this connector right here. Once disconnected, the battery can be manually charged. I'm using these probing cables with a pin on one end and a crocodile clip on the other to attach the charger connects to the battery. I don't really care about messing up the battery connector by doing this, because as long as this thing powers on at all after some charging, then the original battery is going straight to the trash anyway. So it's been charging like this for a couple of hours. Here you can see me reconnecting the battery, and as you can see, it powers up fine. Hey, and even the hard drive spun up and did a promising click. And sadly, it immediately dies as the battery is totally busted. Off to eBay then. So here's the new battery. The replacement process should be quite straightforward. First, disconnect the old battery again. And then disconnect the hard drive by using the spudger to gently pry it away from the connector. Lifting the hard drive spacer mat away from the motherboard reveals the old battery. But I also noticed that there was some oily residue on some of the components, as well as the battery and the hard drive spacer. So I disconnected the hard drive cable by prying it up with the spudger like so, and cleaned everything thoroughly with lighter fluid. To reassemble, the battery goes back in. Then, the ribbon cable is connected to the motherboard by pushing it down like so. Lastly, the hard disk drive goes back in, and the battery is reconnected. Now that the iPod has a battery that can power it for longer than a couple of nanoseconds, I can actually test the iPod proper and see if it produces sound. To do that, the headphone jack that's on the back casing needs to be reconnected. To my relief, the iPod seems to work totally fine. I'm holding the headphones here next to the mic, and as you can see, things are happening on the screen, and music can be heard too. All is good. And that's all for the battery replacement. If that was your goal in watching the video, then all you have to do now is just snap the halves back together, and you'll be done. However, I'm not done with this iPod just yet, and in part 2, I'm going to be showing you how you can replace the internal hard drive with a solid-state flash memory. This will not only make the iPod a little bit quieter, but it will also significantly improve the battery life. That's all I have for this time. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I'll see you again very soon.